You know, I took a walk around the auditorium tonight as you were worshiping, and you know, there's just this sense that I feel tonight that there's just a lot of fear in this room, and perfect love casts out fear, and God's presence is in this place. And I know that from putting this sermon together tonight, we're going to be talking about stepping out in faith and maybe going places you've never gone before. And I think for some of you, even for you to be able to prepare to hear what God has to say for you tonight, you need to put fear aside. Maybe there's some of you need to just come up front and pray and say, God, open my heart, open my mind. Make this the night that I put fear aside, that I walk out and I trust you. There's some people here tonight that you have trust issues in your heart tonight. You have things where you've never trusted anybody. And tonight, I believe that God is going to break that off for you tonight. And he's going to open the windows of heaven, and he's going to flow out like you've never had before. And I just know that tonight is going to be a monumental night. It's the week after Easter, and the enemy's coming in like a flood to try to detract and destroy the word that was planted in you. And we're going to just defeat it right here at the outset of this service and give God free reign. So when we just sing that one more song, take us out to where we walk out where we've never gone before. Can we do that? How many of you just felt something lift off you? Did you feel that? That God just lifted something off you? That's the absence of fear is in the midst of trusting our Father. Father, we thank you tonight for what you're doing in this place already and what you're going to do, God. And we just commit ourselves to you in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God is good. Amen. And we're so glad that you've come to Faith Center Xchange Recovery Service, and we're all about recovery in here, and we're all about giving the enemy a black eye, and you're a part of that. So We want to welcome you if you're visiting with us for the first time. The ushers have a little packet of information that they want to give to you and have you fill out so we can get to know you a little better and know how to pray for you. And so if you're visiting with us for the first time, would you just slip your hand up in the air? We've got a little coffee card for you, and the ushers will bring something around. Anybody here visiting for the first time? Right over here. Anybody over here visiting with us first time? We want to welcome you. And do we have Lifeline in the house tonight? All right. Good job. And Open House Ministries, do we have you guys in the house? Awesome. And anybody else? Longview's down here. Kelso's down here with us representing. And we're just having a great time here. And God is doing some amazing things. And stay tuned. We're going to be starting at the Kelso campus with a Friday night recovery service the 12th of June, June 12th. And that is going to just be amazing. And a lot of you, we need your help. We need some children's workers. We need some worship leaders. We need everybody, because we're going to go up there and make just an amazing time. And right now we're going to take our offering. If the ushers would pass out your the little envelopes. And if you have an offering tonight and you want to put in the envelope, the buckets will come around here in a minute. And God is so good, isn't he? How he's provided. And heard of some jobs that were landed this week. And how many of you know that with those jobs comes a commitment to the Lord? If he gave you the job, he gave you the increase, then you ought to be faithful to him. Amen. And you might want to do that tonight. And if you're making a check, you can make that check payable to Faith Center Church, and you get a tax deduction at the end of the year. And once we receive the offering, would you just stand back up with me, and we're going to worship the Lord. Continue. Part of our worship is giving, and we're going to worship the Lord tonight together, and then just stay tuned. We're just going to have a great night. How many of you are awake? Are you awake? Not still in an Easter food coma. I think I've recovered this week. I did have some amazing tacos last night, and that sort of put me back a little bit. But let's just worship the Lord as we give to him.
Join us as we pray over this offering tonight. Thanks, ladies. Thank you. All right. Heavenly Father, we just want to honor you, Lord God, with our finances. Lord, we want to trust you with absolutely everything. Yes. It says in your word that wherever our treasure is, there our heart is also. And Father, we want to give it all to you, Lord, and we just want to trust you with every need that we have. Father, bless us. We just thank you, Lord God, for what you're doing, and we just give you all honor and praise tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Thank you, ladies. Thank you, worship team. We play the link.
Good evening, guys. This is Elizabeth here, and I just wanted to welcome you to Faith Center's Xchange Recovery Service. Whether you're watching at home online or here with us in the building, thank you for coming tonight. This is just a friendly reminder, if you do have your cell phones, please turn it to silent. That way you don't disturb the friends around you. Also, for parents of small children, we have provided a parent lounge as well as a nursing mother's room to my left with a live feed of the service, just in case your kids get a little fussy. And here are a few announcements.
Hi, my name is Shane, and I'm with Recovery 360, and we're pleased to announce that we have our meetings four nights a week, Sundays, Mondays, Tuesdays, and Wednesdays at 7 o'clock. Please come out and show your support. We appreciate it.
Hey guys, starting March 1st, we're going to be selling some NAAA merchandise right here in the church lobby after service and at the Xchange Recovery Center. If you're looking for coins, key tags, Xchange Recovery sweatshirts, book bags, anything recovery related, see Andy after the service or head on down to the Xchange Recovery Center. All the proceeds go to help our recovery community.
Men's Bible Study meets every Wednesday at 7 p.m. in the KFC room. Women's Bible Study meets every Wednesday at 10 a.m. and 7 p.m. Elevate Youth Ministry, grades 6 through 12, meets every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Green and Gold Meeting meets Friday at 7 p.m. Volunteers needed to start exchange service in Kelso. Sign up at the Info Center.
Welcome, Faith Center Exchange.
Welcome, guys.
How are you guys today? Good? Did you guys all have an awesome Easter? Wasn't that awesome? Let's give our worship team and everybody that helped with Easter services a big hand. Yes. What an amazing, amazing time just to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. All right, let's welcome our online audience tonight. Judy Z in Ridgefield, Tina McIntyre in Arizona. We have Carly from Omaha, Nebraska.
Hi,
yes.
Hey.
Hi, Carly.
Hey, guys.
And Brock is home sick with a bad... Brock has a bad back, so that's your only excuse to miss. No, just kidding.
They have internet in Nebraska? Sorry.
I think so. She said, yeehaw. Yeehaw, Nebraska. Yes. JV kids, you can be dismissed.
Bye,
Lauren. Bye, everyone. Poor kid. All right. So here at Faith Center Exchange, we love to celebrate clean and sober birthdays. Yeah? All right. So anybody celebrating under a week tonight, please stand up. There we go, Jillian. Yay.
Good job.
Awesome. Proud of you. How about 30 days today?
30 days.
30 days right here, Carissa.
All right, Carissa.
Good job. Right on. 60 days.
All right.
Right here. Right here, right here. Good job. Awesome. Right over here, too. Awesome. All right, 90 days. 90 days right here.
Awesome.
Woohoo. How about 6 months tonight? Whoa, 6 months. All right, congratulations. How about 9 months? Anybody with 9 months?
9 months.
No, everybody skips 9 months.
No.
How about, sorry, it's very important. 1 year, how about anybody with 1 year tonight? Right here,
right.
1 year.
Good job.
Woo! Congratulations. Anybody with more than a year celebrating tonight?
More than a year.
Anybody? Tonight? No? I want to do something. We want to have anybody that has over a year clean and sober, please stand up so we can show these newcomers that it really does work.
Awesome.
Yes. Woo! Awesome. Beautiful. Beautiful. And of those people, I need anybody that has gone through our housing program for Grace Ministries and the Exchange, please stand up. If you've been in our housing program or are in our housing program, Andrew, that's you too. Anybody in our housing program, in or has been? Okay.
You guys are a success.
You guys are, yeah, beautiful. God has set a foundation for you guys, and it's so beautiful to see how you guys have stayed plugged in and staying clean and sober, doing the deal, and taking what God has laid out as a foundation with good, healthy habits and doing something different, right? How many know if you want something different, you got to do something different? Right? Amen. Yeah. We're so proud of you guys. Next weekend is Breaking Bread. We're going to have our time of fellowship after church, so be sure and make a plan for dinner here with us after service next week. We've got where's Daryl and Heather? Where are you guys?
Here.
Stand up, you guys. This is a beautiful couple that they make dinner for us each month. Woohoo! Thank you. So that's next weekend, don't forget. And also Sunday is our Finding Peace. We reopen that group. It's the DBT, Dialectical Behavioral Therapy. I am not going to mess that up ever again. That's this Sunday from 4 to 5:30. And where is my love? Oh, there she is on the camera. Hi, Cammy. Cammy's our teacher for Finding Peace. So that's a wonderful group. How many have taken the DBT classes at one time? Awesome. Well, it helps with emotional regulation.
I probably need that class.
No, you don't. Yeah. You could probably teach it. No. It's a really amazing group, though, because it kind of helps you not get so run by your emotions, right? Getting so sideways. The enemy just loves to try to get us all twisted up and sideways to get us off track, and we really need to learn how the skills necessary to make sure we don't do that, right? So we also have
Bill, Ken, and Donnie,
and Aaron.
Ken
Jennings.
How'd he
Is he
get
here
in
tonight?
On that
He's
deal?
Going to Mexico. We have some Xchange missionaries.
Can he get a passport?
Yeah, we actually want you guys to come up so we can pray for you.
We're going to pray for you. They're going to Mexico.
We're
going
to send these guys off. They're going to Mexico on Wednesday, guys. Yes.
Just come down here.
Oh, you want them down front?
They're going to the Mexican prison to minister. So, pray for Mexico.
Who said
first.
That? William Balaban?
Yes.
You come up here and you pray for these guys.
He's going to pray for them.
Yeah, you're as red as your shirt.
Pray for these brothers.
Send them off.
Yeah. This is going in the deep end, brother.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this time and this pleasure to make it through another day. Give us the strength and the courage to send these three, four genuine gentlemen to over there and give back what was freely given to them and give them the strength to give back. And please, Jesus, watch over them.
Yes.
And Mexico, watch out for them.
Amen.
Bye.
Amen. Amen. All right.
So just awesome. Real quick.
Did you leave him with the mic?
I've been very blessed to be able to go a couple other years, but this year we have lined up. We are going to go a week from Monday. We'll be in a Mexican prison, and it's a 3-hour service. It's a true jailbreak. But the following Monday we will be going to a faith-based men's recovery house. Tuesday we'll be going out to the garbage dump, and quite frankly, the only thing that we take down there is beans, rice, and Jesus Christ. So we appreciate and we'll take each and every single prayer. It's easy to get into the country. The difficult part is getting back out. But, we've been successful 5 years in a row, and I see no reasons why this year is any different. We stay with a couple that literally sold everything and cooked top ramen off the hood of their car. We will be helping out the kids down there with a little bit of vacation Bible school and that sort of thing as well, too. So the only other thing that really comes up is what God lays in front of us. So,
cool.
Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you.
I just want to say, me and Aaron have been trying to do this GoFundMe for the past couple of months, and I personally want to say thank you for everybody that has donated to be able to give me and Aaron this opportunity to be able to go down there. It's something that I personally need right now. I need a soul shocker, I want to come back and not take stuff for granted. I want to come back like a changed man, because I'm not perfect, man. I fall short daily. And, I was able to go to a service, funeral service today, and Bill was talking about the dash, and you know, I need something different right now, and thank you for the opportunity, and personally, thank you again for anybody that donated and helped us get down there.
Good.
Yeah, and we'll need to pray for Heather and Wendy too, because they're going to be without their husbands for a week. Anyways, so do you guys want to stand up and pour them? They'll be on vacation, I think. If you guys want to stand up and shake somebody's hand around you, we'll get into the Word.
Amen. Come on back. Come on back. Let's just get into the Word and run a little bit behind, but it's going to be good. Would you pray with me? Father, I thank you for what you've done in this place so far. And right now, as we open your Word, I pray that it would just change us from the inside out. We just give you praise and thank you for your Word and what you mean to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Been continuing our series, took a week off and talked about hope last week, but we're jumping back in to the storms of life because I really feel like there's some things that we need to know and we need to learn. And I've been reading this book by Tony Cook, and just phenomenal. Every time I read one more chapter, I go, man, I got to share that. And so you guys are getting the benefit of this book without even opening it, and so I may have to charge you something. But it's amazing to look at it from his perspective and to look at the Word of God. And how many of you know that every time you open the Word of God, it should be fresh? Because God's Spirit uses the Word of God to speak to our heart. And I'm learning more every day that I open God's Word. And I, my prayer is that you will too. Shane, it's good to see you from Seattle. Came down from Seattle to see us. And Shane Runyon. In Proverbs 10:25, it says, and this is a cool scripture that you guys can just grab hold of and run with. And I know you will. When the storm is over, there's nothing left of the wicked. Good people, firm on the rock foundation, aren't even fazed. Does that sound like somebody like you? Somebody like me that you just stand up and say, yeah, what do you got, devil? Because that's what the Word of God is about. That's what it talks about in the New Living Translation. It says, when the storm of life come and the wicked are whirled away, but the godly have a lasting foundation. And what you guys are doing each week when you come in here and you listen to the Word of God, and hopefully you're reading the Word of God at home, and you're laying a foundation, because the Word of God is the thing that inspires you. It's the thing that motivates you. And a key thought that I want to share with us tonight is, we talked about Jonah and his disobedience, but the disciples got into their storm when they were doing exactly what Jesus told them to do. And you may be facing a storm tonight because of doing exactly what God is telling you to do. How many of you know that that's when the storms come sometimes? It's just amazing that as we go on down the path, and I know Vicki and I face this all the time, that the more we press in and the more we go forward, it seems like automatically the enemy comes. And what's really cool is now we're beginning to realize it, and we're just being, really? Is that all you got? Really? Because we're standing on that foundation, and we're thinking about that. And in the previous sermon on Jonah, we learned that we need to face the truth and take responsibility for our own actions and the things that we've messed up on. And you guys are professionals at that, because you do. It's amazing when you're given direction and you take the direction and you turn about face and you go and you do the suggestions mostly. And it's really cool to see that happen, because then God can work in your life. And so in this particular sermon tonight, we're going to discover that not every problem that we encounter is due to a mistake that we've made. Aren't you glad? Not every storm is a Jonah storm. There's been a tendency, I think, a lot of times, and especially when I was growing up, for among some Christians, to assume that people who are facing a hindrance or a negative circumstances must have a lack of faith, right? Or maybe they have sin in their life. Or, I mean, I can remember a time when I was going through a real battle in my spiritual life, and just seems like everything was just in turmoil back in the 90s. And I was running a youth group over in Ridgefield, and the youth group was just going off the charts. I mean, we had kids standing out the flagpole every Wednesday morning, 100 kids and 200 kids in youth group, and things were going awesome, and God was moving, and kids were getting saved. But yet the enemy was just seemed to be attacking me in my personal life and attacking my finances. And this saint of a man comes up to me, this elder of the church comes to me and says, "Pastor, we need to sit down and talk. I think there must be some sin in your life that you're not confessing." And I'm going, "What? Well, yeah, you know that there's some things going on in your life, and there must be unconfessed sin in there somewhere." And I'll tell you, his theology was whacked. It really was, because that's not the way God works. It's just not. And I had to go. It took me a long time to get that religious spirit and that hurdle out of my life and just put it behind me and say, no, I am serving a God that is amazing. And if you're facing hindrances or challenges and obstacles in your life, do you automatically assume that maybe you have a lack of faith? Sometimes we do. Sometimes the enemy is subtle, and he comes in and he tries to plant those things in those thoughts in our head, or maybe there's something that you're just not perfect at. Well, welcome to the club. And when facing problems, do we tell ourselves that God just must be ticked at me? And so I want to share with you some things that, well, it's true that storms can come as a result of disobedience in our lives. It can come from when we've done nothing wrong. And in Mark chapter 4, I love this story. Jesus was teaching by the Sea of Galilee, and on this particular day, he had shared the parable of the sower, and he just had this meeting, and he had shared his heart with these disciples, and what's amazing is what followed his teaching. And it really goes along with, it seems like each week we share the word with you, and then what follows in your week to come, because the enemy comes to try to steal. And so Mark 4:35 through 41 in the New King James Version, it says, "On the day, the same day when evening had come, he, Jesus, said to them, 'Let us cross over to the other side.' Now when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and the other boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, and so that it was already filling." So you get the picture. They've just had this great, amazing church service, right? And Jesus has poured out his heart. And so Jesus said, "We must go to the other side." So they jump in the boat, and they begin going to the other side. And now the waves come, and so it was already filling. The boat's filling up. And the disciples are going, okay, we probably shouldn't have gotten in the boat today. It's probably their first thought, right? Just like maybe sometimes you have had things in your life where you feel like, should I have really stepped out in faith? But he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow, and they woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" How many times in our lives have we said to God, "Do you not care? Do you not know? God, the life sucks right now." And the disciples had been spending time with him. They knew him personally. And for them to wake him up and say, "Do you not care? Do you really think that he didn't care?" But a lot of times that overshadows our circumstances, doesn't it? And then he arose and he rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said to them, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" I see us here. I see me here. And that's why I love to share the Word of God, because I see me there. Because You see, I'm just like you. I don't have all the answers. I'm not perfect. I have not arrived yet. And God's working on me. But he said to them, why are you so fearful? Why is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly. They were still freaked out. They feared exceedingly and said to one another, who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him? They've been with Jesus. He's been sharing miracles. He's been doing all this stuff. And they still come back to the point, one more time he showed himself. This really is the real deal. And I think we get in that mode sometimes in our own life where there's circumstances come up and we don't really trust and we don't really believe, and we're no different than the disciples. And so this is why I wanted to share this with you tonight. We're seeing how the disciples encountered adversity when they were doing exactly what Jesus told them to do. And I think what's happening right now, there's a shift. And you guys are starting to plug in. And now you're starting to do exactly what God tells you to do, and the fire is getting turned up, right? And some of you are going through some issues and some things that aren't brought on anymore by your disobedience, because now you're walking in the right way. But there's stuff coming down on you because you're doing the right thing. Can anybody testify to that? I mean, wow, okay, maybe I'm doing this for a reason tonight. This shows us that there are two times, I mean, we can get into it for disobedience, but we can also get in it because we're doing the right things. In Isaiah 43, it says, but now this is what the Lord says. You want to know what he says? It says it right here. He who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. That's God's word to you tonight. So you're going down the deal and you're doing everything God told you to do, and all of a sudden the enemy comes against you. What do you say? You quote this scripture. And it says right there that, and this is interesting because it says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. That tells me that when the bottom falls out, I will be with you, right? So isn't that comforting tonight? Not really. But isn't it comforting that he says he will be with you? The uncomforting part is that when you go through this, also it says when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. For you people who have one nostril out of the water right now, you're going to be okay. It will not take the other nostril down, and you are going to survive. Because when you go through the rivers, it says that they will not sweep over you. Then look at this. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. You're not going up like a human torch, right? It's amazing. The New Living Translation says, when you go through deep waters, I'll be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, and I think I felt that tonight in this place, oppression. And you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. And there's some of you here tonight that you feel like the flames, you feel like things are just consuming your life. And even though you've made the right choices, let's look at some things that in this particular passage. The first thing, Jesus gave a directive, let's cross over to the other side. Some of you here tonight, Jesus has given you a directive not to go back to the old way of life. He's calling you and giving you a directive. Let's cross over to the other side. And I'm sorry to tell you, but there's going to be some hurdles along the way. There's going to be some difficulties along the way. But the promise is that he will be with you. And Jesus gave that directive. Also, the disciples did precisely what Jesus told them to do. And you, some of you tonight, are still bullheaded. But there's a lot of you tonight, and I won't mention any names, there's a lot of you tonight that are doing exactly what God told you to do, and that's exactly what the disciples did. So they were sitting in the boat, and they're going, what in the world is going on? He told us to get into the boat, and we're going to drown. The third thing is a great storm arose. This wasn't a minor storm. This was, it's filling the boat with water. I mean, even the professional fishermen are freaking out, right? And they had been, they knew the waters, they had been in storms, and they were terrified. And so we can get terrified, or we can relax in what God has for us. The other thing is Jesus was asleep in a small boat with that was being battered and was filling with water, he must have really known how to rest in God. And I think we need to take that picture of Jesus laying in the stern of the boat on a pillow, sleeping when everything is chaos round about him. How can we do that? We can do that by what God has promised us in his word. In Psalms, it says, 127 says, "It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for so he gives his beloved sleep." We're just doing all this crazy wondering, oh, what's going to happen? You get up early, you can't sleep, and you can't sleep at night, and you're bringing on sorrows, and you're thinking about all this stuff that's going wrong. And it says right there in God's word, "For so he gives his beloved sleep." Are you his beloved tonight?
Yes.
Yeah. You are chosen. It said right there, he's going to walk with you through everything. And now he says he's going to give you sleep. So maybe tonight when you lay your head down on that pillow and everything starts swirling around and the enemy brings this and that and the other thing and court and child support and all that stuff, maybe you can just say, check it out. God said he'd give his beloved his sleep, and I am his beloved. And so you're going to sleep. You see, the disciples were terrified. They asked, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" When we're facing a crisis, there are two things we need to avoid. First thing is avoid assuming that God does not care. Really. Don't assume that he does not care. Don't ever interpret God's love in the light of the circumstances that you're facing. For example, don't say, "If God really loved me, I wouldn't be facing this problem." That's simplified for me. "And he must not love me." Avoid that. I mean, it's called catastrophic thinking. Jesus spoke to the storm, and he exercised spiritual authority through his spoken word. How many of you know that you and I can speak to the storm and exercise spiritual authority in our lives? The spoken word is powerful. That's why you got to get in there. In Mark, it says, he said, "For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, 'Be removed and be cast into the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says." So what do? There's a therefore. It says therefore, that means this is what you do. "Therefore I say to you, whatever this you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you will have them." But what do? Mope around and say, "Oh, I can't believe what's happening right now." Or do you speak the word of God? Do you say, "What? Let me ask you tonight, Lifeline people, what mountain are you facing right now in your life that you need to speak to?" Just like they did there. What mountain are you facing? You don't have to answer me, but I know that for a fact that there's some of you that are facing some mountains that you need to get over. And it says right there in God's word that whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Do you need housing when you get done? Do you need strength to go through all the past wreckage? Probably. What do you need? I've seen those mountains crumble. How many of you have had those mountains crumble? And it's amazing. It wasn't by your own ingenuity, I'll guarantee you that. Because you tried that track. You tried that track. And it didn't work. You all broke out in handcuffs many times. But the minute you decided to speak to the mountain and trust God, it's amazing what began to happen. You see, the disciples were awestruck by the power that Jesus released through his word. And we should be awestruck at the power that God releases through his word. Jesus had his disciples, I mean, they made it safely. And I want to get to this part. It's amazing the reason that they went to the other side. And they went across the lake to the region of Gerasene. And when Jesus got out of the boat, a man with an impure spirit came from the tombs to meet him. Think about the things that you've put into action in your life because of what God's doing in your life right now. And what if those disciples would have said, "God, we're going back. We're not going. I mean, the water is coming over the bow. It's closer to the shore there than it is to the shore way over there." And you may be in here tonight feeling like it's closer to just tuck and roll and turn back to the bushes and all that craziness that you were involved in than it is to go the distance, right? And what happened is they got to the side and the man lived in the tombs and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been chained hand and foot, but he tore the chains apart and broke the irons on his feet. You know what this, when I read this scripture, I began to think about methamphetamines and heroin addiction and alcohol addiction. And this man was waiting for someone to come to the other side. And what if they'd have given up? My question to you tonight is, what if you give up? What if you give up on the calling that God has on your life? It says no one was strong enough to subdue him. That sounds a lot like some things I've seen. Night and day among the tombs and in the hills he would cry out and cut himself with stones. What does that remind you of? You know, often I drive through Hazeldale and Rosemere and Orchards and just pray. And often I see people walking the streets, talking to themselves, probably a lot like the man in the story. You see, we're living in the midst of where God has put you to make a difference. And it says, when he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and fell on his knees in front of him. He shouted at the top of his voice, "What do you want me? What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" It was part him and part demonic. "In God's name, don't torture me," for Jesus had said to him, "Come out of this man, you impure spirit." Then Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" "My name is Legion," he replied, "for we are many." And he begged Jesus again and again not to send them out of the area. The demons knew their time was up because they were in the presence of Jesus and they were going, "Wait, don't we? If we get out of this guy, just at least leave us in the area so we can keep messing stuff up, right?" Even the demons knew that their time was over. And at the name of Jesus, the demons tremble. And so pick up the story. A large herd of pigs was feeding on the nearby hillside. This is a really cool story. You got to go back and read it and study it. It's really cool what happened. The demons begged Jesus, "Don't just end our life. Send us among the pigs. Allow us to go into them." He gave them permission, and the impure spirits came out of the guy and went into the pigs. And the herd, about 2,000 in number, I mean, this is a big herd of pigs. Some farmers ticked. Rushed down the steep bank and into the lake and were drowned, right? This farmer's going, "What? I mean, God comes and takes my pigs." It's got to be what he's thinking, right? I mean, I just reading the story and I'm thinking, what's the farmer thinking, right? I mean, these were my pigs. What did my pigs do? I mean, can you just picture 2,000 pigs running down the deal? And I mean, it says that there were legions, and that's about 6,000. So there are 6,000 demons went into 2,000 pigs. What is that? 2 times 3, that's 6. So three demons per pig. I mean, they're freaked out, right? I don't know. I guess I look at the word a little different, but I was just reading what it said. Because look what happens next. I mean, we raised a pig once. Squirrel. Okay. Those tending the pigs ran off and reported this in the town and the countryside. The people that owned the pigs ran off and reported this in town and the countryside, and the people went out to see what had happened. I mean, where did my pigs go? And when they came to Jesus, they saw the man who had been, listen to this, the story gets amazing, because they came and they saw the man who had been demon-possessed by legions of demons sitting there, dressed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. They were religious folk. They didn't know what to do with this meth head that just got set free. Right? They're going, "Man, this dude's going to mess up the church." Right? He's going to mess up our whole deal, man. The pigs are gone and we got a meth head. I mean, what is going on up in here? And those who had seen him told the people what had happened to the demon-possessed man and told us about the pigs as well. And then the people began to plead with Jesus, just get out of here, really? You're coming over here, taking our pigs, setting meth heads free, and putting them in the church. What is wrong with this picture, right? I was just reading into it. And as Jesus was getting into the boat, okay, Jesus is getting in the boat now. He says, okay, I messed up this town. I'm on to something else, right? And so, he goes over and gets in the boat. The demon-possessed dude that just got set free and he's clothed and in his right mind comes to Jesus and says, Jesus, man, it's been a rough life. Would you just take me with you? Amen. And Jesus says, no, you need to stay in Hazeldale. And Rosemere and Orchards and keep messing with these people because you've been set free, right? And God has done this, and it's just amazing to see that Jesus did not let him but said, go home to your own people, your own tweaker friends, and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you and set you free. I mean, that is some good stuff. And I don't know why, but I thought of Heather Knutson, or Heather Evans. Because she's a reformed tweaker. And Heather, I began to think about when we first met you and how distant you were. You didn't really know about this whole Jesus thing, this whole church thing, and slowly but surely you just kept pressing in.
Oh, I don't even know where to begin. Man, I've had a lot of demons for sure. Well before I ever put drugs in my body, you know, I had so many demons growing up. I had a drug addict mom who ended up dying of an overdose. And from that, you know, I went on and got into the first worst relationship I possibly could and was almost killed on a regular basis by a very angry man. And so before I even ever touched drugs or experienced that, I had so much baggage that I brought to that, and then I met meth, and I thought it was going to fix everything, and make it all go away, and it doesn't. And man, I really struggled with that for a long time. You know, there is a lot of stuff that comes with drug use. For me personally, the shame and guilt I felt as a mom. You know, I just kept popping out these babies, one right after another, and I had a 5-year run in prostitution. And a lot of shame and guilt with that, that comes with that. And what I can tell you about that today is God has taken all those demons from me, you know. I was very apprehensive about coming to this church. Bill and Vicky just led me up, and you know, some of you guys have heard, like, we just started going on these little dates together, and you know, they just really led me through that process, and how grateful I am for that, because really I have an incredible relationship with God today. How I know those demons are gone and how I know that God took those from me is, you know, last year when my world fell apart, and it did. You know, I didn't have to act out on anything that I would have done in the past. I didn't have to punch anybody. I didn't have to go to jail for a DV. I didn't even raise my voice when he left. I never even acted out in anger. I just knew and I just trusted God's plan for me. And the biggest thing is I didn't have to put drugs or alcohol in my body to not feel that.
Amen. Amen. That's good.
Yeah. So I haven't done it perfect by any means, but I'm doing it. And, like, I got to walk through that experience with grace and integrity. And, like, God is by my side, you know. When my job allowed me and afforded me the opportunity, which they changed my schedule, man, I came and parked my butt on these chairs every day on my way to work because I was seeking God in that discomfort, you know. And, you know, like Bill said, you know, since I've really started pressing in here, you know, it gets tough sometimes, but I'm not going anywhere.
Awesome. So tonight, as I think about this story that we read, and I'm running out of time, my thoughts go to the fact that what would have happened if the disciples had not gotten in the boat that day and gone over to the other side? And what do you suppose the fallout was of that demoniac man that was set free? As he sat there in his right mind and fully clothed, and all of those around about came to see. Just like there's some of you here tonight that you are in your right mind and you have it together now, and people from all over are coming to see what took place. Better yet, what would happen if you don't get in the boat and go to the other side? How many people will miss out because of that? Maybe here tonight and you'd say that, Pastor Bill, I've never really experienced Jesus in my life, and I want to give you an opportunity tonight to just accept him. And there's this picture that we share each week, and it's a picture of Jesus standing at the door, and he's asking you tonight to open the door of your heart and to just ask him to come into your life and change you. And it's a simple little picture. It's just, but to me, it's really amazing that Jesus would stand at front of me and say, Bill, I want to come in and change your life. And all I had to do is say, okay, and open the door. And that's all you have to do. So if you're here tonight and you'd like to have one of these cards to take with you, I want to just give you one. Vicki, you'll go over there and. I'll be right there. There goes too. In just a moment, I'm gonna have those who took one of those cards, I'm going to have you come up front, but just stay where you're seated for right now. I'm going to do that in a minute. But there's something else that just came to me. Maybe you're here tonight and you've accepted the Lord and you've been walking down the path, and all of a sudden you feel like God's telling you to get in the boat. And you're standing there thinking, man, I don't know. I don't know. I've never gone there before. I don't know what that's going to be like. I just feel like as we go to Longview and Kelso, and we begin to take more territory and we begin to do more things in the ministry. I remember all the times that Vicki and I would stay up late at night praying and crying and going, I don't know. I don't know if I want to do this anymore. I'm just tired. I don't know. And then I think about Heather's testimony. There was times where, I got to be honest with you, I didn't want to get in the boat.
I didn't want to experience the waves. But somehow God's faithful, and he gives you the strength. He gives you the endurance. And some of you here tonight, I just know that you need to come tonight, come forward, and we want to pray for you first. And maybe you need to make a recommitment tonight and say, you know, I got to get in the boat. That's all there is to it, because there's people on the other side, the demoniac man in Rosemere, Hazeldale, Vancouver, Orchards, in this area, Longview, Kelso. There's somebody that you're going to reach. And so if you feel like that's you, come first, and we're going to pray for you. And then we're going to pray for those who took a card. I'm going to ask Pastor Glenn and Therese, can you just come and pray for these and behind them? Jared, good to see you. Good to see you getting in the boat. Jeremiah, welcome back. Carissa. Wow. Guys, I can just picture you standing at the bank in fear, not knowing what the outcome is going to be. I'm here to tell you it's the biggest rush you've ever had. You can understand what I'm saying, right? It's the biggest rush you've ever had when you step out and you're in the middle of the will of God and the storm comes raging and you stand up and say, yeah, well, check this out. You don't know who my daddy is, right? And you stand firm, and it says there in a word that you stand firm and you're on the foundation and you cannot be moved. The wicked are whirled away, but you stand firm and you cannot be moved. And so this is your time tonight. This is your opportunity to press in and take some territory, cross the waters, and go for it. Father, we come into your presence tonight, and we're so thankful for what you're going to do, for what you're going to unleash in these neighborhoods, Father, as warriors and soldiers for you stand up and take back this territory in the name of Jesus. And drive out the enemy and drive out drug addiction in Clark County and begin to do amazing things in the kingdom of God. And Father, I pray for an anointing right now. I pray for a restoration right now. Father, I pray against the scars and the damage and the anguish and the shame and the guilt and all of the things that the enemy brings to their mind daily. Father, I just come against it in the name of Jesus. And I speak freedom into their life. And I speak wisdom and knowledge and understanding of your word. And Father, I pray that they'd be able to use your word like they never have before and wield it like a sword and cutting into the dividing of the marrow and going deep into the things that you have for them, God. I just pray a hedge of protection around their minds right now in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
You guys can... You guys can go ahead and have a seat. Now, for those of you who took a card tonight, I want you to come on up, and we're going to pray for you too. And I'm going to ask Aaron Oxford to come on up. Those of you that took a card tonight, I want you to come right on up. Come stand right up here with me. You took one of those cards tonight. I want you to come up here, and this is going to be a life-changing moment for you in your life. And Glenn and Theresa, can you just come and lay hands on these guys? And God is doing amazing things in your life. You know, I remember when Aaron and Wendy came to the Lord, and I remember Aaron had to go take the rap for somebody. And went to prison. And Wendy stayed back. And I remember how Aaron, I could see the look in his eyes and how he was committed to do what God called him to do. And I don't think he's ever looked back from that day. And he made the same commitment that you guys are making right now. And now he's a man of God. And he's doing amazing things for the kingdom. And so Aaron's gonna lead you guys in a prayer tonight.
Just go ahead and repeat after me. Father God, I give myself to you.
Yes.
And I ask you to take me, Lord. Do with me what you will, Father. Mold me. Create me into men and women of you, Lord. Father, as I turn my life over to you, I commit myself to you wholly. I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
I thank you, Lord.
And I thank you, Lord.
And I am yours, Lord.
And I am yours, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. All right, guys, let's go rock it for the kingdom. Have a great week and bring back a friend next week, okay?